Good morning. Let's begin our review of the entire AP Physics C mechanics curriculum, and we will start with kinematics.
Flippin' physics!
Class, dimensions are our friends. In other words, we have to remember the units for everything, and we have to identify every number answer with units.
Unless it doesn't have units.
Like mu.
Yeah.
Correct. It also means we have to be able to do conversions. Bobby, please convert the density of the gas krypton at standard temperature and pressure of 3.75 grams per centimeter cubed to kilograms per meter cubed.
Okay, multiply by 100 centimeters over 1 meter and cube it to cancel out centimeters cubed. And multiply by 1 kilogram over 1,000 grams to cancel out grams, and we now have 0.375 kilograms per meter cubed.
And now vectors versus scalars.
Mr. P?
Yes, Bo?
That answer is not right. It should be 3,750 kilograms per meter cubed. I think Bobby forgot to cube the numbers as well as the units.
Yeah, that's right.
Bo, thank you. That is absolutely correct. Students will sometimes forget to apply an exponent, which is outside of parentheses, to everything which is inside the parentheses. I see it all the time. Okay. Class, a vector has both
magnitude and direction.
And a scalar has
magnitude only.
This difference might seem minor, however, it comes up on every AP physics exam. One example is that momentum is a vector, and students will sometimes forget to include both the x and y directions when solving a conservation of momentum problem. Billy, what is the equation for velocity?
Are you asking for average or instantaneous velocity?
That is an awesome question, Billy. Please give me both.
Okay. Average velocity is change in position over change in time, and instantaneous velocity is the derivative of position as a function of time.
And Bo, what is the difference between average and instantaneous?
Average means over a time period, and instantaneous means at a specific point in time.
And what does the derivative represent?
The derivative gives the slope of a line.
We can also write out the equations for average and instantaneous acceleration. Average acceleration equals the change in velocity over change in time, and instantaneous acceleration equals the derivative of velocity with respect to time. Now let's talk about uniformly accelerated motion, or UAM. We can use the UAM equations when the acceleration of the object is uniform or constant. In other words, when the acceleration equals a number, not an equation which changes as a function of time or position. Bo, what are the 5 uniformly accelerated motion variables?
Acceleration, obviously. Velocity final, velocity initial, displacement, and change in time.
There are 4 UAM equations. Now, I know these 4...
Mr. P, those are not the equations we're going to get on the equation sheet on the AP exam.
Now, I know these are not the UAM equations which are on the equation sheet which you're going to get on the AP exam. So I want to make sure you understand the differences between what I've written here and what's going to be on that equation sheet. So, the first of the equations which I've written here is written as such on your equation sheet. Velocity in the x direction equals the velocity in the x direction naught plus acceleration in the x direction times time. Billy, what does this naught or this zero as a subscript mean?
Velocity naught or velocity zero means the velocity at time t equals zero or the initial velocity, correct?
Correct. So v sub x naught means the velocity initial in the x direction. I instead write v sub I for velocity initial, and I add subscripts whenever necessary. And there's also this difference between the change in time and time. change in time equals time final minus time initial, and using t for time final and letting time initial equal to zero means that change in time equals t. But again, remember, this assumes that the time initial is zero. Bobby, what about this v sub x on the left-hand side of the equation? What does that mean?
That is the velocity final of the object in the x direction, right?
Correct. So you can see this first equation on the equation sheet describes the final velocity of an object as a function of time, assuming that the time initial is equal to zero. And here are the other two UAM equations on the equation sheet. These last two UAM equations have displacement replaced with position final, or x, minus position initial, or x naught. And I don't know why my last UAM equation is not on the AP equation sheet. Okay, class, using my UAM equations, how many UAM variables are there?
Five.
And how many UAM equations?
Four.
And if you know how many of the UAM variables?
Three.
You can find the other?
Two.
Which leaves you with one?
Happy physics student.
Which is always fun. And I will point this out. Velocity is the derivative of position with respect to time. And if we use the UAM equation from your equation sheet of position as a function of time, and we take the derivative of that with respect to time, we get the first of the UAM equations, which is pretty cool. Okay, let's move on to the concept of free fall. An object is in free fall if the only force acting on it is the force of gravity. In other words, there cannot be any air resistance. I like to call this being in the vacuum that you can breathe. When this occurs, the acceleration in the y direction equals the negative of the acceleration due to gravity, or the negative of little g, and the acceleration due to gravity here on planet Earth is positive 9.81 meters per second squared, which means when an object is in free fall, the acceleration in the y direction of that object equals negative 9.81 meters per second squared, or 9.81 meters per second squared down. This means free fall is an example of uniformly accelerated motion where the acceleration is equal to a constant negative 9.81 meters per second squared. And you can use all the UAM equations. Bo, please walk me through all the graphs for position, velocity, and acceleration as a function of time for an object that is in free fall, dropped from a height of 2.0 meters.
Is there any air resistance?
Unless it is otherwise stated in AP Physics, we are always in the vacuum you can breathe, so no air resistance.
Okay, let's start with the acceleration graph, because that one is the easiest. We know the acceleration is a constant. It's constant at a value of negative 9.81 meters per second squared, so acceleration as a function of time will be a horizontal line at negative 9.81 meters per second squared. The initial velocity of the ball is zero, and the slope of a velocity versus time graph is acceleration. So the velocity versus time graph will be a line which starts at zero and has a constant slope of negative 9.81 meters per second squared. The position as a function of time graph will start at 2.0 meters, and because the slope of a position versus time graph is velocity, the initial slope of the position versus time graph will be zero. As time goes forward, the velocity becomes more and more negative, so the position as a function of time graph will have a negative slope, which increases in magnitude over time. So it will be concave down until the position final is zero.
Bo, thank you. That was very impressive. Let's move on to component vectors. Component vectors are the vectors in the x, y, and possibly z directions, which, when added together, result in the original vector. Billy, please determine the component vectors of the acceleration vector 2.5 meters per second squared at an angle of 26 degrees east of north.
Well, the x direction uses cosine, so the acceleration in the x direction is 2.5 times the cosine of 26, which is...
No, it's not. You have to draw the vectors out and use SOHCAHTOA.
Mr. P sets up his examples this way. to make sure we show our work.
So once we draw the vectors, we can use sine theta equals opposite over hypotenuse, which equals acceleration in the x direction over acceleration, multiply by acceleration to get acceleration in the x direction equals acceleration times sine theta, or 2.5 times a sine of 26 degrees, which equals 1.09593, or with two significant digits, 1.1 meter per second squared. We can do the same thing with cosine theta equals adjacent over hypotenuse, and we end up with the acceleration in the y direction equals acceleration times the cosine of theta, or with numbers 2.24699, or with two significant digits, 2.2 meters per second squared.
Which brings us to the unit vectors I, j, and k, which are vectors with a magnitude of 1 in the x, y, and z directions, respectively. In other words, Bobby, what is, in unit vector form, an acceleration of 2.5 meters per second squared at an angle of 26 degrees east of north?
Well, we just determined the components of that vector in the x and y directions. So the acceleration is 1.1i plus 2.2j meters per second squared.
What is that weird hat symbol over the I and J?
That is the symbol for unit vector, and yes, it is often called a hat.
Oh.
So these two expressions describe the same acceleration. Plus, unit vectors make vector addition much easier. For example, let's say we are adding together three displacement vectors for an object. Without unit vectors, we would need to break every one of these vectors into its components in the x direction and the y direction. Then we would need to add all the x values together, and then all the y values together, and then determine the magnitude and direction of the resultant vector. However, because all of these vectors are in unit vector form, all we need to do is add all the vectors in the x or I direction together, and add all the vectors in the y or j direction together, which is a lot easier. And notice also, this gives us the r vector to identify the position of an object. Because it's not just the position in the x or y direction of an object, the r position vector can give you the position of the object in two or even three-dimensional space. Next, relative velocity. Relative velocity is vector addition. Let's say we need to fly a plane due north relative to the Earth in wind which is blowing eastward. What direction do we fly the plane? We know the velocity of the plane with respect to the Earth equals the velocity of the plane with respect to the wind plus the velocity of the wind with respect to the Earth. And we need to draw a tip-to-tail vector addition diagram. And you can see the plane needs to be flown in a northwesterly direction. Let's move on to projectile motion, where an object is flying through the vacuum that you can breathe in both the x and y directions. Bo, what is our general strategy for solving projectile motion problems?
We start by listing our known values, but we split them by direction, listing what we know in the x direction and what we know in the y direction separately, because an object in projectile motion only experiences the force of gravity, which is in the y direction. The object has no net force in the x direction and therefore no acceleration in the x direction. That means the velocity of the projectile in the x direction is constant, and we can use velocity in the x direction equals displacement in the x direction over change in time. In the y direction, the object experiences free fall, so the acceleration in the y direction equals negative 9.81 meters per second squared, and we can use the UAM equations. And the variable which connects the two directions is time, because time is the only variable which is a scalar. And we usually have to break the initial velocity into its components.
That completes my review of kinematics. Next, you can enjoy my review of dynamics, which is Newton's three laws, forces, equilibrium, and so forth. Or you can visit my AP Physics C review webpage. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.